Daily Millets nummer 1472 met een uitzending van vandaag 17 november 2018. Dit is het bulletin van zaterdag. Today's bulletin will be in English. Het bulletin vandaag is in het Engels. We hebben het ARRL audio nieuws en daarna de column van Onno. We have the ARRL audio news and after that the podcast of Onno.
This is ARRL audio news, your weekly summary of news highlights from the world of amateur radio.
I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, and I have a note for our listeners. Because of the Thanksgiving holiday, audio news will not be distributed next Friday, November 23rd. Audio news will resume on November 30th. And now, here are our stories for Friday, November 16th. AMSAT is counting down to the launch of the next Fox 1 satellite, Fox 1 Cliff. According to Spaceflight Now, the launch from Vandenberg Air Force Base of Spotlight's SSOA SmallSat Express mission on a SpaceX Falcon 9 vehicle is currently scheduled for November 19th at 18:32 UTC. Fox 1 Cliff carries the Fox 1 UV-FM repeater, AMSAT's L-band downshifter, the flight spare of the AO85 Vanderbilt University Low Energy Proton, or LEP, radiation experiment, and the standard Fox 1 Penn State University ERIE, MEMS gyroscope experiment. Virginia Tech provided a video graphics array camera that's similar to the one on AO92, but which will provide images at a higher 640 by 480 resolution. More information about the launch and early operations phase will be released prior to the launch. Fox 1 Cliff is named in honor of longtime AMSAT member, contributor, and benefactor, the late Cliff Butchart, K7RR. His contributions to AMSAT and other amateur satellite programs, including his service as an advisor during the initial development of the CubeSat specification at California Polytechnic State University, earned him the Lifetime Achievement Award from Project Oscar in 2006.
And now with this week's satellite update, here's Bruce Page, KK5DO.
Fox 1 Cliff is launching soon, and AMSAT needs your help. Really, we do. Following the successful launch and deployment of Fox 1 Cliff, all amateur radio satellite enthusiasts can play an important part in the commissioning of the new satellite. Telemetry helps us tremendously, starting as soon as possible after startup, which is about 59 minutes after deployment, and for about the next 72 to 96 hours, we will be looking for successful startup. Watch the general health and function as the satellite begins to acclimate to space and start to perform the on-orbit checkout. If you are the first station to successfully receive and submit telemetry to the AMSAT server, you will receive a special 3D printed QSL card acknowledging your contribution. If you are capturing telemetry with Fox Telem, please be sure that you check Upload to Server in your settings and your ground station parameters are filled in as well. You can help AMSAT and everyone waiting to get on the air with Fox 1 Cliff tremendously by capturing Fox 1 Cliff telemetry. In the initial safe mode after startup, which we will call beacon mode, the transmitter is limited to 10 seconds on time, then does the 2 minutes off cycle. Those capturing telemetry will only see current frames and no high or low frames because the high and low frames are truncated as it takes just over 10 seconds to send 2 frames. You also hear Veronica announcing Fox 1 Cliff safe mode while in the beacon mode. The downlink frequency is 145.920 MHz AFSK. The Fox telemetry software can be downloaded from the AMSAT.org website. Thanks to Jerry N0JY, AMSAT Vice President of Engineering, for this story. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO, for the ARRL Audio News.
December is Youngsters on the Air Month, or YODA Month. Listen for stations on the air with YODA as the call sign suffix. YODA is primarily an International Amateur Radio Union Region 1, that's Europe and Africa, activity, but youngsters from the U.S. and Region 2, the Americas, have attended YODA summer camps, which are held in a different country each year. YODA stations are, in general, operated by individuals 25 or younger. The operating event takes place for the entire month of December UTC. As part of YODA Month, Bob Johnson, W9XY, and Ken Clairbout, K4ZW, will travel to Ethiopia to team up with the club at the Addis Ababa University Institute of Technology and Club Station, ET3AA. For more updates, visit YODA's Facebook page. Ocean County, New Jersey Amateur Radio Emergency Service volunteers recently assisted search groups looking for a man with dementia who was reported missing on November 2nd from a nursing home in Stafford Township. Searches concentrating on neighborhoods around the nursing home had been unsuccessful. The missing man's family organized a search for November 10th, and Ocean County Aries was invited to participate. Ocean County Aries Emergency Coordinator Bob Murdoch, WX2NJ, had been informed that the search would focus on a wooded area. Tim Tonneson, NJ2N, was instrumental in contacting the local authorities and working with the family and search teams to organize a search plan, while Murdoch looked after the communications technical side and personnel. Temperatures had dropped overnight to around 32 degrees Fahrenheit, and it had rained considerably the night before. Aries established a net control station at a nearby park, where power, shelter, and rest facilities were available. The search teams were made up of volunteers from the community, more than 140 in all, and the Aries team agreed to coordinate communication among search groups. A VHF repeater proved unreliable for use with handheld transceivers, and communication ultimately took place using a UHF repeater in Toms River, maintained by Ocean County Aries members. Topographical maps were used to plot out the search areas. By 1 p.m., the individual had not been located. Aries members assisted in making sure all volunteers had been accounted for. The search continued that afternoon without success, and volunteers returned to the rallying point. The plan is to continue the search over the following days. Montenegro and Lithuania are the latest countries to announce adoption of a new amateur radio band at 5 MHz. Both countries have authorized amateur operation on a secondary allocation of 5,351.5 to 5,366.5 kHz at up to 15 watts EIRP. Amateur radio operators associated with the Maritime Mobile Service Network played a significant part in summoning medical assistance on November 9th for a crew member suffering chest pains on board the 48-foot sailing vessel Maria Elena, some 300 miles east of Bermuda. The assistance we received from the ham radio operators was crucial in helping us communicate with the vessel's crew, said U.S. Coast Guard Petty Officer First Class Travis Unser. Unser was the search and rescue coordinator for the incident. NET member Donald Plunkett, VA6FH, heard a call for medical assistance at 1650 UTC on the NET's 14.300 MHz frequency from Nick Cancro, KC2WRH, the captain of the Maria Elena. Cancro reported that a crew member was experiencing severe chest pains and needed medical assistance. Fellow NET operator Fred Moore, W3ZU of Inverness, Florida, had good propagation with the Maria Elena and contacted the vessel, linking it via a phone patch to the U.S. Coast Guard station in Norfolk, Virginia. The Coast Guard was able to connect the patient directly to medical personnel via the phone patch to ascertain symptoms and prescribe first aid measures prior to medical assistance arrival. Moore arranged with the Maria Elena to contact him at the bottom of the hour throughout the night and to call immediately if the patient's condition worsened. The U.S. Air Force also came on frequency at the Coast Guard's request to evaluate the situation and see if it could assist. Due to the sailboat's distance offshore, the Coast Guard directed the captain to head toward Cape Hatteras, North Carolina. The Coast Guard then redirected the cutter Spencer, underway near the Virginia-North Carolina border, toward the Maria Elena. The Spencer rendezvoused with the sailboat at about 12:30 UTC on November 10th, launching a small boat crew and transporting the man aboard the cutter. A short time later, a helicopter crew was able to hoist the man aboard the Spencer and transport him to a hospital in Norfolk. Moore was assisted by a relay station, Mark Strotham Sr., KC9YRX, in Wisconsin, who provided much-needed information throughout the incident. Additional Maritime Mobile Service Net members pitched in as well.
I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and I'm speaking with Bart Gyanke, W9JJ, the ARRL Radio Sport Manager. And Bart, what's the state of the grid chase?
The state of the grid chase is strong numbers, Steve. Very strong numbers. Coming out of October events, as received and recorded in logbook through the 10th of November, we're showing over a 60% increase in activity between the stats that were reported during the month of September and now the new stats recorded for October.
Any idea why the sudden increase?
Certainly. Best focuses always as we come into fall activity is the lower bands become more active. We've got less focus to the VHF bands. We've got less noise on the lower bands. It's the normal fall progression as we get into lower band activity.
Okay. Any bands or modes in particular?
With a big focus, 15 meters came way up, almost 200% over the previous month. Yep. 12 meters, big numbers as well, went from 838 QSOs confirmed up to 6,711.
Wow.
Yep.
That's amazing.
And overall, we had about 91,000 QSOs confirmed during the month of September. That number raised to 148,000 in the month of October.
Now, does sweepstakes this month have any role in that?
It will in the November stats, since we're currently reporting on October.
That's true, yes.
November will close out by the 10th of December, but it's always best to point out these focuses of we just came off of the CW sweepstakes weekend a couple of weekends ago. Phone sweepstakes is this weekend, and let's not forget, for those who are VHF aficionados, you've got the EME contest coming up on the Saturday and Sunday after Thanksgiving. You've got the 160 contest on the first weekend of December, and then the second week of December is the 10-meter contest, and maybe rounding it all out is Rookie Roundup on the 16th of December.
Oh, that's right. I completely forgot about Rookie Roundup. That's true.
So these are all great contributing factors to what should be a really strong December.
Very good. So the grid chase has effectively another 45 days left. Is that correct?
Exactly. And I think it's going to be a really strong 45 days, and people are going to be looking to fill in some of those holes on the grid maps. It's going to be a lot of fun for everyone.
Excellent. Thank you, Bart.
Thanks, Steve.
This is the ARRL Audio News Propagation Forecast for Friday, November 16th. There was a spot on the sun earlier this week, but it was so small it was almost invisible, and it really did little to raise the solar flux index. By the time you hear this, it will probably be completely gone. When this forecast was recorded, we had just made our exit from one stream of solar particles, but another one is due to arrive Sunday or Monday. So what does this mean for the upcoming sweepstakes weekend? Well, if we're lucky, geomagnetic disturbances won't become an issue until after the big contest is over. Even so, conditions may still be challenging. If you're hunting for a clean sweep, it will be possible, but you'll have to keep an eye on propagation and jump from one band to another as the paths open and close. On VHF and UHF, conditions haven't been favorable for tropospheric ducting lately. The two exceptions are Florida and Central California.
And that concludes ARRL Audio News for this week. Our thanks to all contributors to this week's report. ARRL Audio News is produced by the American Radio Relay League, the National Association for Amateur Radio. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at arrl.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment about ARRL Audio News, email us at audionews@arrl.org. This program is copyright ARRL, all rights reserved. 73, and thanks for listening.
I'm Ono of the Foundations of Amateur Radio podcast in Australia, and you're listening to the Daily Minutes by Papa Alpha Zero Echo Tango Echo. Foundations of Amateur Radio. The other day I read a message from Theodore, Kilo Sierra 5, India, who's been around the block a couple of times. He recalls the excitement he experienced when he was first licensed in 1967, the year I was born. He described that at the time transistors were just coming into their own, and it was so wonderful to be learning about them. The closing sentence sealed it for me. Theodore wrote, Perhaps it's time for some of us more mature operators to release the past so our hands are free to grab hold of the future and share the enthusiasm of those who look ahead with the same hope and excitement that we had so many years ago. It's that level of enthusiasm that our hobby needs to foster and develop. The landscape we live in is changing all the time, but new adventures are always just around the corner. They might not look like what was available 50 years ago, or last year, or even yesterday, but they too have their place in the pursuit of amateur radio. Learning is a lifelong activity. If you stop learning, you, as Theodore eloquently puts it, just die. Learning can be scary. Educator Eduardo Briceño talks about the learning zone and the performance zone. The learning zone is when the goal is to improve, concentrating on what we've not yet mastered, and the expectation is that mistakes will happen. The performance zone, on the other hand, is when we do something as best we can. We concentrate on what we already know and try to minimize mistakes. Amateur radio can operate in either of those zones. Doing a contest and going hard can be a performance zone activity. Do what we do, do it fast, and avoid mistakes. We could also see our activities as a learning zone. We try new things. Some will work and some will fail. If we're doing a contest as a learning activity, what skill do you want to master? Is it handing off the QSO? Taking the log? Recognizing a call sign? Knowing the CQ zones? Matching prefixes to countries and antenna directions? Picking the right band? Managing battery life? Or recognizing the band conditions? Pick one of those skills and try different things, expect mistakes, and learn from them. Over time, the thing you practiced will be a new skill you've mastered, ready for use when you're going hell for leather in the CQ worldwide, making contacts left, right, and center to the envy of your peers. Of course, this doesn't just apply to contesting. For me, it's currently about electronics, about figuring out how stuff works and how to apply that to my shack. For you, it might be something else in the myriad of options that the 1,000 hobbies that amateur radio represents. Life is about growing. Amateur radio is a journey, not a destination. Closing off your options because valves are no longer in vogue and All-Star isn't real radio is just a recipe for stagnation. If you have a dozen minutes to spare, check out Eduardo Briceño's TED Talk, How to Get Better at the Things You Care About. One final point. If you're new to this adventure, your license still wet, then you don't know what you don't know, so you'll spend lots of time in the learning zone. Don't be afraid. It's a great place to be and a wonderful way to explore the hobby in all its variety. I'm Onno, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima Alpha Bravo.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechts bovenaan de webpagina van de uitzendingen www.pa0ete.nl. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De internetfaciliteiten en studiohardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl. 70MHzShop.nl.
En microfoon naar retour.